Britain is home to some of the most iconic dishes in the world.
Fire!
From fish and chips to pie and mash, afternoon tea to roast beef and Yorkshires.
Now it's time for the roast!
Our national favourites have been hundreds of years in the making.
Whoa!
I want to reveal the untold stories behind them.
Rubs up!
How roast beef fueled the building of an empire. How fish and chips saved us in the war. And how curry changed the face of modern Britain.
I've never had a chilli that hot.
I want to find out why they're so deeply rooted in our culture. I'll be hopping into my time machine to explore their secret histories.
This looks wrong.
Looking for inspiration to create an epic culinary salute.
Let the feast begin!
Now I'm turning my attention to afternoon tea. I'll explore the horrible history behind its dainty facade.
It's sheep droppings.
Let's put some in.
And unearth some unusual cake recipes that time forgot.
Basically looking for horns.
To find inspiration for an afternoon tea party that the Mad Hatter would be proud of.
Oh, my God!
That is the noise of magic.
Cheers!
Afternoon tea. It is about as British as it gets. Dainty finger-sized sandwiches, scones, jam, clotted cream, and jewel-like little tiny cakes. In fact, it's what the rest of the world think we do before going to play a game of cricket or singing God Save the Queen. Cheers.
But why is afternoon tea such an iconic meal? I want to find out why we love it so much and if there's more to this decadent treat than dainty sandwiches and doilies. So, the first stop on my culinary tour is the Langham in London, the first ever hotel to serve afternoon tea, back in 1865.
It almost makes it more decadent that you can eat all those sweets in the middle of the day and not feel guilty about it.
That's what the Queen does.
It's a nice way to spend an afternoon with some friends.
It just makes you feel very special, and you just come away for a couple of hours and you sit here and you're in a little world of your own, and it's lovely.
Do you have afternoon tea in Belgium?
No, that's why we're here.
So did you come over?
Well, did you come over here? Yes, especially to here to experience afternoon tea.
That was great. I mean, on the face of it, you just think that afternoon tea, pointless ritual? It's not. It's decadent. It's opulent. It's celebratory.
Afternoon tea actually makes us feel special, regal even, which is fitting because legend has it was invented here at Woburn Abbey around the mid-1850s by the Duchess of Bedford.
She got that sinking feeling mid-afternoon and requested a small plate of sandwiches and cakes to be sent to her room with a pot of tea.
And so a brand new meal was added into the day.
Good afternoon, Albert.
Hello, Aunt Eva.
I want my afternoon tea to be a truly inspiring, exciting affair. To begin with, it's time to turn my attention to a nice slice of a sponge.
Before the invention of baking powder, cake baking was a really tricky business. Cakes were hard and flat, so chefs would beat in egg whites for back-breaking hours in a bid to try and make the cake rise in the oven, with mixed results. I'm heading back to the late 1830s, when a speedier technique was invented. Believe it or not, they discovered that powdered deer horn was an effective raising agent. Joining me at Woburn Abbey is food historian Annie Gray to help me try and apply this early science to my afternoon tea.
So basically looking for horns?
Yes, they shed them, I think, in March during the rut.
This is obviously either fallen off or been rutted off.
Yeah, I think it's all snapped looking at this, isn't it?
So what relevance did this have in baking?
Well, you're not just shaving the hartshorn into it. You're using a product called salvolatile, or hartshorn salts, or salts of hartshorn, and it's derived from deer antler. And it's heat-activated, so unlike other raising agents, it's something you can just stick in a cake, put it in the oven, and it works.
It generates gas.
Yeah.
And it's that gas that causes the cake to rot.
Yeah.
We're really going to try and turn this into a beautiful cake.
Yes!
The rotted deer horn will be dried and then turned into a powder.
So this is our extract of deer horn. So this is just the salts that we're going to use to raise our cake. So by taste. All means, have a taste.
Smell.
They don't smell of much.
Oh. 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 It's ammonia.
Yeah.
It's complete ammonia. It's like putting, it's just eating rotten fish. Oh, it's grim. Why would you ever want to put something like that in any recipe on this planet?
Well, we'll cook the recipe and then hopefully we'll see why. We're going to start off by cooking a cake, which it's basically a sponge cake. Up until about the early 17th century, most cakes are yeast risen. And they tend to be, they're not heavy, heavy, but they're a bread. This is where cake, sponge cake, and all its various derivatives, chocolate cake, coconut cake, carrot cake, anything that involves a light rise, this is where it all comes from.
OK, time to see if it works. Let's add the magic ingredient to the eggs, butter, flour and sugar.
So now we're going to add our key ingredient. OK, in goes our extract of deer horn. Often cakes would be moulded at this point. The recipe suggests we should sugar it rather than flour it. So then we just pour it in. Right, so this is done and can now go into our moderate oven. And then when it's done, we can take tea.
Time for tea.
Well, here is our cake out of the oven. Slightly green.
I was going to say, we didn't put any green ingredients in, did we?
No. It's got a nice texture.
It certainly has a lightness to it. OK, come on then.
We could do it together. 3, 2, 1. All right.
That's inedible. Oh, there's a taint.
There is a fizz.
I certainly wouldn't recommend putting ground deer antler in any cake ever in the world again, ever. Britain's bakers battled on until 1843, when Alfred Bird of Bird's Custard fame invented baking powder. Suddenly, everyone could make their sponges light and fluffy, using the recipe that we still use today. And soon after, a quintessential part of afternoon tea was born, the Victoria sponge sandwich. The story goes that when Prince Albert died, Queen Victoria, she was distraught. She went into mourning, she went to seclusion. And the chefs thought, right, she had a famously sweet tooth. So they created a Victoria sponge to try and lure her out of her mental and physical condition. That's where the Victoria sponge was born.
Just look at that. Light as a feather and trembling with naughtiness.
And I found one of the earliest recipes from 1861. Which I'm trying out with cake baker to the stars, Peggy Portion.
And first I cream the butter and the sugar together.
The ingredients are the same as I used earlier in that disastrous sponge cake. But instead of deer horn, we're using self-raising flour. So all self-raising flour is flour, plain flour, with baking powder. This was invented within like a couple of years, 2 years of baking powder. Somebody goes, actually, why don't you just mix them together and sell it? And that's all self-raising flour. Traditionally, Victoria sponges were cooked using a square cake tin, and they weren't filled with either cream or buttercream.
Place this onto a cake board.
Stuff the cake board.
Oh, my God. You forgot that, the icing sugar.
That is why it's called a Victoria sponge sandwich. I mean, you can see why this has become such an iconic cake.
All I want now is just a cup of tea.
The original Victoria sponge is wonderful, but it's pretty conventional. I want to do something that the Mad Hatter would be proud of. I'm going to create an afternoon tea that defies convention, where nothing is quite as it seems, and I want the Victoria sponge to be the centrepiece. Next, I create sandwiches out of cake.
So in true afternoon tea style, I'm just trimming off the crust.
And an edible cake stand to serve them on.
So here is my homage to the Victoria sponge.
By the end of the Victorian era, afternoon tea was an important part of an upper-class lady's day. It was a time to gossip, admire the latest fashions, and of course, serve everything on the best china to impress your friends.
Good servants are difficult to come by because the lower classes prefer to work in factories.
When it comes to afternoon tea, the tea service is as important as the food itself. So I've got to incorporate the tea service into my afternoon tea, but in a way where nothing is quite how it seems.
I'm off to Wedgwood for some inspiration. Historian Jenny McLaughlin's given me a sneak peek behind their factory doors, where they've been making fine bone china for aristocratic afternoon teas since 1744.
You cannot have afternoon tea.
No, you can't.
Without fine china cup and saucer, and you need a kind of cake stand.
You absolutely do. And there's something incredibly indulgent and multifaceted about fine bone china and tea together. The rich Europeans loved it because it was so white, and whiteness is really crucial in the whole tea story. You want to see the colour of the tea. Tea was such a precious commodity that people who could afford to drink tea wanted to showcase the quality of their tea.
Wedgwood also produced very intricate designs, where much of the process is still done by hand.
So that's £1,000, that plate?
It takes a week to produce one plate.
And how much is that teapot?
I think it's around about £7,000.
£7,000 for a teapot?
Yep. £66,000 for a dinner service.
Remarkably, they're letting me have a go with the most expensive paint I'll ever use.
This is liquid gold. It really is. It's £22,000 a bottle. Perfect. This is what it should look like. And this is what my work of art looks like.
All right, maybe it's best to leave the decoration to the experts. But being here has given me some inspiration about how I can serve my Victoria sponge.
I want to celebrate the most iconic British cake and one of the most important parts of any afternoon tea, and that is the Victoria sponge. So I thought, what better way to do that than to make a cake stand out of Victoria sponge? So here's how I'm going to do it. I've got two white chocolate plates that are basically molded from a plate. And here I've got some buttercream. So I'm just I'm going to pipe this around the plate. OK, next, a thin disc of sponge cake and just lay that on top of the buttercream. So, obviously, you can't have Victoria sponge cake without jam. So, in here, I've got some strawberry jam. And then just, again, pipe onto the sponge and then spread over. OK, now it's time just to seal the plates together. So I'm just working my way around the plate, sticking the two halves of the plate together. So now I'm going to pop this in the fridge to let it set and then give it a nice lick of paint with some cocoa butter. And it will come out looking like this. And then just to finish it off, I've painted a thin band of gold, edible gold, around the outside.
I've got the plates for my edible cake stand. I just need some cakes to go on it. But as my afternoon tea turns everything on its head, my cakes will be disguised as sandwiches.
To begin with, I'm going for an afternoon tea classic, smoked salmon and cucumber on malted brown bread.
But the bread is, in fact, an Earl Grey tea-scented sponge cake.
I'm going to spread my special butter, which is actually a pastry cream, with extra cream added. So now I'm going to slice my cucumber, which in fact is not a cucumber at all. It's an apple jelly, which I've then dipped
in a mint and parsley jelly for the skin. So next, a couple of slices of the finest smoked salmon. The smoked salmon is a mandarin, blood orange, coconut and apricot, pâte de fruits. It's basically like a giant fruit pastel.
One that's been moulded and sliced with a serrated knife to create the salmon effect.
So in true afternoon tea style, I'm just trimming off the crust to make the sandwiches as dainty and delicate as possible.
I'll also be serving plain Victoria sponge cake with banana and peach filling, which is masquerading as a ham and cheese sandwich.
So here is my homage to the Victoria sponge. Sandwich cakes and edible plates.
That's the nicest plate I've ever tasted. And this brings me to the next element of my afternoon tea, the most important item to be served. Tea first arrived in the 1670s from China, and for centuries it's remained our national drink.
Lovely. It's not everyone who can make a good cup of tea.
I love tea. I drink gallons of the stuff. So for my afternoon tea, I want to create my own unique blend. So for inspiration for that, I'm going to travel back to a time where teas were blended with all manner of weird and wonderful ingredients.
The 18th century was a time when tea was heavily taxed at 119%, making it more expensive than gold. To avoid the huge import duties, smuggling tea was big business, and criminal gangs would add all manner of ingredients to bulk out the tea leaves and increase profit. So I've come to a Surrey tea shop to meet food safety officer Ben Milligan, who's going to reveal the secrets of what people got up to.
Why don't you tell me about crimes against tea?
Well, what we're going to do is look at tea as a sort of cocaine of the 18th century and how it was adulterated. Right, we're a couple of smugglers. We've got ourselves some high-value tea from China.
Yeah.
It's cost us a lot of money to get it, mind.
Yeah.
And we're going to add some things to pad it out.
First off, some leaves commonly found in a hedgerow.
What's this one then?
Hawthorn, just quite sweet.
Okay, let's stick back some of that in.
Some of the ingredients used were a bit nastier.
Well, that's dust. Straight out the Hoover.
All right.
But you do know that dust is mainly made of dead skin particles.
In goes some sand.
Last but not least.
It's sheep droppings.
Yeah.
All these ingredients were added not for taste, but to purely bulk out the tea.
There could be fecal coliforms, there could be pathogenic bacteria in there. It could be spores, there could be toxins. So these are all things that could give you gastroenteritis. Let's put some in. Get the big one in.
Give it a good mix and a few minutes to let all those delicious ingredients gently infuse. Well, it looks like tea, but how will it taste?
OK. This is my dusty, sandy, pooey, tree-like, leafy, twiggy tea. It's bitter. I wouldn't want more than a sip.
No.
It's not bad. And inside I'm just a geek.
That wasn't good. It's really peppery. That's horrendous. A lot of the people that were having it, they hadn't had tea before, so they wouldn't know what it looked like, tastes like, and they were just happy to get some.
I mean, that for me is pretty undrinkable.
OK, so some of those ingredients were just a step too far. But amongst the horror, there's one ingredient I think could be useful, hedgerow leaves.
I wouldn't be surprised to find that flavour in a tea.
Yeah.
And who better to test my new hedgerow infusion than the ladies of the Surrey WI.
Hello, ladies, how are you?
It's quite flowery, quite light, isn't it?
Delicate taste.
Yeah. Mm. Got Ashley's hawthorn leaves. I did leave out the dried sheep's poo.
No, no, thank you.
I left it out. I left it out. I thought that would not have been fair.
If I'd gone out for tea and someone had given it to me, I would have thought, OK, it's, I wouldn't have said anything about it, so it was good enough.
So a couple of hundred years ago, tea was adulterated by criminals, black market, make loads of money, put any cheap old nasty stuff in. But some of those ingredients actually made the tea taste really nice and people liked it.
So I'm heading to my development lab to come up with my very own afternoon tea blend. I'm starting by infusing Darjeeling tea with a selection of hedgerow leaves, but I'm not stopping there. To me, there's nothing quite like the taste of a mouthful of tea straight after a bite of sandwich. So I thought, why not combine the two?
This is the plan. So down here, I've got some cucumber juice, some dextrose, some matcha green tea powder, and spray-dried cucumber sandwich.
I've used a centrifuge, my machine that separates liquids from solids, to extract the juice from a cucumber sandwich. And then that extracted liquid goes into a spray dryer and I end up with this powder.
Just pop it into this mortar. I'm just going to bind the three powders with a little bit of cucumber juice.
After giving the powders a good mix, I spread them into these specially created tea leaf moulds.
I just need to push the leaves out of the mould. I've got this really little thingy. Right, I just need to pop these into the dryer to set them, and then my tea leaves will be ready. So here is my tea leaf, complete with tea bag tab.
A quick dunk into the hedgerow infusion.
Fully dissolved. And there is my afternoon tea in a cup.
Hedgerow and cucumber sandwich tea blend. Next, I recreate some sandwiches that haven't been made for over a century.
I think it's pretty good. I would actually, I'd definitely consider it.
And put the finishing touches to my unforgettable afternoon tea.
A card trick that I think the owner's sandwich would have been proud of.
I'm planning a show-stopping feast which pays homage to afternoon tea. Now it's time to turn my attention to the sandwiches. The classic afternoon tea sandwich is dainty, delicate, and feminine. But I don't want to give my diners what they expect. So for inspiration, I'm heading back to Georgian London to explore the origin of the sandwich. This was a time of copious drinking and gambling amongst the upper classes. And one prolific gambler was John Montague, the fourth Earl of Sandwich.
Should we gamble?
Let's do it.
I'm meeting historian Kate Williams to find out more.
If you didn't gamble, you were no one. Business was done at the tables, social life was done at the tables. So the Earl of Sandwich, every night after his day at the Admiralty, he'd come down to the casino and he really, really didn't want to lose.
And no more bets, thank you.
I'm actually feeling a bit hungry.
You're feeling a bit hungry?
Yeah.
But the thing is, if you start eating something with cutlery, it'll take you away and I might win.
OK, so what am I going to eat?
The Earl of Sandwich, when he was busily gambling millions away at the gambling table, what he actually said was, I want something quick, just gobble it in and get on with gambling. So his servants had the brilliant idea. They put a piece of meat in between two pieces of toasted bread. And the myth is the sandwich was created.
This is it.
This is it.
This is basically what kept the Earl of Sandwich gambling 24 hours a day.
24 hours a day.
So what was the timescale between Earl of Sandwich creating this and the sandwich becoming basically an everyday food?
The Earl of Sandwich created about 1750, but it really took until about 1773 to really catch on. That's when we see it in a recipe book. By really the mid-19th century, sandwiches were becoming a staple and something that people really saw as the ideal snack. But certainly, through the 18th century, you had them in gambling dens, you had them in brothels, so there's nothing innocent about its founding.
Bank is the winner, 5-4.
Gambling, sandwiches. I never knew the two were so intertwined, although the sandwich itself sounds not very exciting.
I want the sandwiches at my afternoon tea party to surprise my diners, and I'm hoping this Victorian recipe book might just have the answer.
Salads and sandwiches and recipes for making them. It's full of sandwich recipes. I mean, hundreds of them. And whilst there's recipes in there that you recognise, corned beef, for example, there's a whole load of them that you think, really? And one of those really recipes I'm going to try now. In fact, it is consists of these. They're sweetbreads. They are the thyroid gland or the pancreatic gland, and they're very prized in gastronomy. So I'm going to stick them in two slices of bread. When we think about it now, the amount of sandwiches that are consumed in this country is at 11 billion a year. And I've still never seen a sweetbread one. Now I'm ready to assemble the sandwich. Add in my asparagus. Sweetbreads. And I'm adding some egg yolk mashed together with herbs. So then we've got some watercress. I can imagine watercress will go well because I like you get that mustardy, peppered note from cress that will cut through the richness of the sweetbreads as well. Right, so there's my sweetbread asparagus sandwich. I've made three other sandwiches. I've taken the recipes from the same book. I've got chicken livers, bacon, parsley, curry. I've got in here smoked eel with sorrel, baby sorrel. And the final one is cress with bone marrow. So, as weird as these might sound, I think they're all fantastic. I think the Victorians knew their sandwiches, but they're so far removed from the ham and cheese sandwiches today. Right, it's time to find out what the modern day public think of my Victorian sarnies. So here is my sandwich, Wheel of Fortune. Now, in true spirit of the Earl of Sandwich, British sandwich lovers coming out of here can gamble their tuna special for one of these delights. Smoked eel, roasted sweetbread, seared chicken livers, or marrow chunks. So, let's play Sandwich Wheel of Fortune. Roll up, roll up. Do you want to play the sandwich? No, obviously not. Adam? Hello. Can I tempt you at all? It's the Sandwich Wheel of Fortune.
Yeah, OK. Why not?
Ah, cool. First, I have to take your salad.
First up, sweetbreads.
It's good.
So?
Well done.
Oh, good.
Here's the part that you get.
Marrow chunks.
Would you happily come in here and get a marrow chunk sandwich instead of... Yeah.
There goes another Victorian sandwich swap.
Which would be your most feared?
The eel.
As long as it's not the eel.
Yes.
Oh, God.
Not too bad.
No.
I think it's pretty good. I would actually, I'd definitely consider it.
Would you replace yours with that?
Yeah, let's do it.
Nice one. You've got that, you've got... Oh!
It's delicious.
Would you happily have that again?
Definitely.
Good. Thanks. I'm just going to get a cup of tea to get my muffin then.
Enjoy it.
Most of the people that played this very advanced game actually loved those sandwiches. So the Victorians were definitely onto something. One of the great things about cooking is you've got the ability to kind of create surprise, excitement, but above all, fun. And that old adage that says, oh yes, you should never play with your food, quite often, it's just a load of nonsense. In fact, it's exactly what I want to do. I want to combine these Victorian fillings with the story of the Earl of the Sandwich and the gambling den. So I'm making a triple-decker ox tongue and pickle sandwich.
First, I'm using a layer of ox tongue, another brilliant ingredient from that Victorian recipe book.
So this tongue I brined, vacuum packed and cooked really gently for hours. It's really tender. So on top of the ox tongue, I'm going to add some pickled shallots. I'm now adding some little dill pickled gherkins, and then some pickled cauliflower. So I sliced the florets really finely on the mandolin, then some watercress, and this is going to bring a nice kind of peppered flavour to the sandwich. I think for me, the great thing about this sandwich is that it all works so well together because it's so well balanced, the richness, the acidity, the texture. And after finding out bone marrow was such a hit with the public, I'm adding a herb and bone marrow butter. So there is my ox tongue, pickled vegetable and bone marrow butter sandwich, but I'm not finished yet. The Earl of Sandwich had his sandwich brought to the gambling table. I want my sandwich to be part of the gambling table, and that means I need some bays. So, first step is to butter the outside of the sandwich. For the bays, I'm going for red bays, and for that, I'm using dried tomatoes that are ground into a powder. Just dust over the top. And for the black, I'm using powdered squid ink. OK. So there is my red sandwich. Now, if anybody wants to gamble, it'll be red against black. And the black sandwich is going to be sweetbreads with asparagus. Having resurrected these Victorian sandwich combinations, I'm now going to put my own twist on Britain's two favourite sandwich fillings, chicken and cheese. So I'm going to make a classic British sandwich, coronation chicken, and I'm going to put it in an edible playing card. So I obviously need something that's going to be white enough and something that I'm going to be able to spread very thinly to make a really delicate casing, yet will still have a snap to it. So for that, I'm using white chocolate. But I don't want to use 100% white chocolate, because remember, this is a savoury sandwich. So what I've done in here, I've just fried off some chicken skin and rendered the fat from it, added that to the white chocolate mix, which will just reduce the sweetness and boost the chicken flavour, which will work much better with the filling. I'm pouring my white chocolate and chicken fat mix into card-shaped moulds I've specially created, complete with edible transfers. So here, I've got the coronation chicken mixture pureed and passed through a sieve so it's nice and smooth. So I'm going to pop some of that. And then for my bread, I'm using a mixture of fried panko Japanese breadcrumbs, which are really super light, some fried almonds and some roasted crispy chicken skin, all ground up. This is going to give that taste of sort of crunch toasted bread, but also really boost the chicken flavour. OK, so now I need to put the other half of the playing card on. OK, so here are my playing cards. White chocolate on the outside, coronation chicken on the inside. A card trick that I think the Earl of Sandwich would have been proud of. And I'm also going to give my cards another classic sandwich filling, cheese and pickle. So that's my afternoon tea menu nearly sorted. But there's room for a few magical extras, and I'm taking inspiration from afternoon tea's more recent history. By the turn of the 20th century, the tradition of afternoon tea had left the country house and become a commercial enterprise. Now, anyone who could afford to could treat themselves to afternoon tea. And today, top hotels and upmarket tea houses battle to outshine each other with their own afternoon tea creations. And I, too, have my own creation, inspired by the Mad Hatter. You can't have a posh afternoon tea without a posh teapot. And here's mine. It's a chocolate one, of course, but it's no ordinary chocolate teapot. It's really rather special because inside I've lined it with a white chocolate and Earl Grey tea ganache. You pour in the hot water, pop on the lid, and then just give it a little swirl. Okay, now for some tea magic. Out of the pot comes a white chocolate Earl Grey tea. Now, who said chocolate teapots aren't useful. Next, my afternoon tea fantasy comes to life.
It's absolutely gorgeous.
That's amazing!
It's like Willy Wonka.
I've been delving into history to reveal the stories behind the dishes that built Britain and find inspiration for a culinary salute to them. Legend has it that afternoon tea was born when the Duchess of Bedford took tea in her stately home. So to celebrate this uniquely British tradition in the most spectacular way, welcome to Afternoon Tea Manor. Behind these walls lies an afternoon tea filled with culinary surprises. It'll be a celebration of all the elements of this great British tradition. I've created my own adulterated brew, and a gambling food fantasy with the ultimate twist. Welcome to Sandwich Casino. Place your bets, please. And a sumptuous finale. True afternoon tea in the most opulent style. But pay attention, everything is not quite as it seems. Unaware of the tea time adventure that's in store are the guests, the very people who serve us our afternoon tea, waiters, waitresses and tea shop owners.
Greetings to you, the lucky holder of this golden ticket from Heston Blumenthal.
In your wildest dreams, you cannot imagine the afternoon tea experience that awaits you.
Wow. Oh, I bet. I'm so hungry.
Oh my God, I can't wait.
Afternoon, everyone.
Afternoon.
Okay, so to celebrate this totally unique British tradition in the most spectacular way, I'm welcoming you to Afternoon Tea Manor. So, are you all up for following me? Yay! Right, we're going that way. For the first part of their afternoon tea, I'm taking my guests below stairs. Welcome to my smuggler's tunnel.
This is amazing.
I didn't think it'd be like this at all, walking down through the stairs in like the candles out. No, I don't know what to expect now. It's completely friendly.
Inspired by a time when tea was more treasured than gold and criminals would cut it with unspeakable substances, I've created a more friendly infusion made with Darjeeling tea and hedgerow leaves. Tea was adulterated with all kinds of stuff, ranging from sand to dust to twigs to hawthorn and even things like sheep's poo. So, in here... I think you'll be fairly relieved to know there is no poo in this room. And now for my dissolvable tea leaves that'll bring the flavours of an afternoon tea classic right into the cup.
Wow, it's lovely.
Now, definitely the bread comes through really strong.
Tasting the sweetness, the cucumber.
Put both together and you've got a cup of cucumber sandwich.
It's literally like you're eating the whole sandwich.
With a mouthful of tea.
With a mouthful of tea. Like, you don't need to eat the sandwich anymore.
A liquid diet. Way forward.
With their taste buds now tingling, my guests have discovered the secret entrance into the next part of my afternoon tea. Welcome to my Sandwich Casino. This is my grand homage to the Earl of Sandwich, legendary gambler and creator of our favourite British snack. This is Sandwich Roulette. You are gambling for sandwiches. Put your chips on red or black, and then I'm going to spin the wheel. It's black. Okay, so this is the Earl of Sandwich's treasure. And it doesn't finish there. Or there.
Oh my God.
Or there. Inspired by the Victorians' creative fillings, I've combined sweetbreads and asparagus and ox tongue and pickled vegetables.
Don't tell anyone, but I'm vegetarian.
That's the best news I've heard all day.
I think we're converted to gambling if there's sandwiches as a prize.
Yes.
This is a real multi-sensory experience.
Shall we play some cards?
Yes. Yes.
My guests gambling away in my casino have to get their heads around the fact that they can eat what they're playing with.
You've got a 10 at the moment. Would you like to stick or twist on that?
Twist.
A white chocolate and chicken mixture with some classic British fillings. Coronation chicken.
Is this edible?
Yes, definitely.
And cheese and pickle.
That's really weird.
What do you think? You have a winning hand there?
It's like Chinese. Am I right? No?
Playing cards will never be the same again.
Is it cheese and pickle?
That's correct, yeah.
It's beautiful. I love the coronation chicken one. The white chocolate with the fat goes really well and beautiful. Really nice.
Come on, Ike.
12, number 12.
And to raise the stakes even higher, I've created ham, cheese and tomato biscuit casino chips with a gelatin casing.
Oh!
It tastes like a sandwich.
Wow.
It's really refreshing. It's a nice little different texture.
I don't know if I can get my mouth.
No problem.
I'm sure I'll try. Come on, Ike.
It's going to be number 0. Oh. 0.
Better than Vegas. For Heston to come up with such a fantastic experience and to have edible eating cards and edible chips is just, like, fantastic. History coming back to life again.
Yeah,
after all that blackjack, it's time for a bit of refinery and the final part of my Mad Hatter afternoon tea.
This room is amazing.
Isn't it?
It's stunning.
So we're really happy to see Doilers.
Yes,
yeah,
definitely.
We're really happy.
After all, innovation does not exist without tradition. And I've still got a few tricks up my sleeve.
OK, so this is the finale of your afternoon tea experience, where not everything is what it looks like. Tuck in.
What will my guests make of their sweet sponge cake, masquerading as sandwiches?
And this looks like smoked salmon and cream cheese. It's not smoked salmon and cream cheese.
No, it's not.
No, it's an Earl Grey sponge cake with a mandarin and blood orange jelly.
Mine's a Victoria sandwich.
Is that really?
I think so.
That's amazing.
It's so bizarre.
It's so weird to taste something so different to what you're expecting.
It's like Willy Wonka. It's like going into Willy Wonka's factory and you think it's one thing and it's just not. It's something totally different.
Yeah. Oh my God!
My guests have discovered that their cake stands are edible.
Oh, wow.
Either Bakewell tart or Victoria sponge, both covered in white chocolate.
Ooh,
that's
it's
nice.
A Victoria.
That is really
fun. Yeah. That was so much fun.
You have to leave it with me.
I wonder if the Duchess of Bedford would approve.
There's nothing ladylike about that.
And this is my pièce de résistance, a chocolate teapot that's actually useful. With a secret chocolate ganache lining, this makes a very special cup of Earl Grey tea.
That is the noise of magic.
That's amazing. Put in
hot water
and it's come out tea.
It looks like tea, it doesn't taste like tea.
Is it Earl Grey chocolate?
Yes,
Earl Grey tea.
It is.
It's really delicious.
And you don't even need to wash up.
Of moving.
Even the cups and saucers are edible.
Cheers.
But how am I going to pour the tea?
It's really hard to put down in words just how amazing it is, because you think, oh, I'm going to be able to eat this. But then when you sat here and I'm like, if I want, I can just, like...
That's really cool.
Being here and seeing all this, it's been great.
He definitely did afternoon tea proud. It was like an angel dancing on your taste buds from the start to the end.
I'll never forget this.
Cheers!
In its heyday, afternoon tea was the hottest ticket in town. It was opulent, it was exciting, it was the place to be. And looking at the guys in there, I think I've managed to bring that history back to life.
Life lessons for kids and their parents. Stream it or download it to Mr. Drew's School for Boys. Catch up when you like through 4OD. We're unlikely to learn much in the next 55 minutes, but chances are we'll have a laugh. 8 out of 10 cats does count down with Jack D and James Corden next.